BGMC. The biblical truth lives here.
The ancient Hebrew scriptures foretold of the Anointed One, Yeshua HaMashiach. The Messiah Yeshua came to call the people back to the truth of His word and to follow that righteous path. Yeshua then called Jewish men to be His disciples, and after His death and resurrection, those Jewish men told the world about the Jewish Messiah. Now, after 2,000 years, Beth Goyim Messianic Congregation has that same calling of those Jewish men, telling all people, both Jew and Gentile, about the proper ancient path, teaching the Route 66 King's Highway from Genesis through to Revelation, and how you need and can get back to the proper roots of the faith and a closer walk with God. Now, let's hear the message.
Let's go get a blessing. Turn to the book, the Gospel of Mattiyahu, Matthew chapter 6. Please, Matthew chapter 6. This is message P259. They thought they were part of his family. This is the, from what I gather, since I'm also not seeing them on the line, this is the last message that is directed only towards the Philippines, and we will invite other people. We are going to keep doing these messages, but we may start at 11 p.m. New York time, so that we cover half the world, okay? So this is the last message. The Philippines has decided to do something else, but we will still be broadcasting the message of truth and of our Messiah. And tonight, we take a look at that. P259, this is the last P message. It'll be starting E260 next week. The synopsis of the message: there are many flavors of Christianity and Messianic Judaism. Today, there are many, let me say it again, there are many flavors of Christianity and Messianic Judaism today, as there is ice cream in the world today. And the sad part is there would not be all those flavors if all people held this scripture close to their heart. Matthew 6, verse 33 says, "But seek first the kingdom of his righteousness." We're going to have one theme for tonight's Erev Shabbat message. It's going to be entitled, "They thought they were part of his kingdom, but they were eternally wrong." Okay? Imagine you live your whole life as a four-hour Messianic Shabbat keeper. Imagine you live your whole life as a three-hour Sunday Christian. And in both of these cases, thinking when you die, you get to the pearly gates, and you think you're going to walk right in. You go to open the door. It is locked. You shout to the guard, "Let me in." Then finally, Yeshua himself comes to the door. You say, "Hey, Yeshua," or "Jesus, I guess I am dead, so can I come in your house?" Yeshua says to you, what? We're going to look at the Gospel of Matthew chapter 25, verses 1 through 12. They thought they were part of his family. Luke chapter 13, verse 22 to 28. They thought they were part of his family because they ate at his table. Matthew chapter 7, verse 21 to 23. "I never knew you, and you thought you were part of my family." Revelation 22, 14, verse 22, verse 14 through 16. "Anyone who loves and lies and gets tangled up in falsehood." Mattiyahu 19, verse 25 to 29. "Who can be saved, not getting tangled up?" Matthew 12, verse 48 through 50. "Whoever does what is what?" 1 Yochanan chapter 2, verse 17. We're going to go through a bunch of scriptures in this hour-long teaching for Erev Shabbat. As I said once again, we're going to keep continuing after 5 years of messages. We're going to keep continuing right now, I believe so, for the next long time, as long as the Lord allows us, to broadcast here at 11 p.m., to cover the other half of the world with a live messianic message from a true biblical place called Beth Goyim. And we're going to prove that tonight through the scriptures, what Beth Goyim stands about. Let's go to Matthew 6, verse 33. Matthew 6, verse 33. Matthew 6, verse 33. Water's good. Matthew 6, verse 33. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Let's read that verse again. Matthew 6, verse 33. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Amen. If you learn anything from this ministry, learn this. Always seek first his kingdom. Don't seek me. Don't seek rabbis. Don't seek pastors. Seek God first. Now, the rabbis, truly trained rabbis, and those who follow the law in spirit and in truth, they're going to guide you. But the key here to learning anything is seek the Father's kingdom. Okay? Now, let's see what the word seek means, because there's going to be three key words that help you to understand the rest of the message. Okay? Three key words. Seek is number one. Kingdom is number two. Righteousness is number three. So let's see what the word seek in the Greek is. That is the word logos. Okay? Seek. Seek first his kingdom. So what does seek mean? One, of speech. Number two, the sayings of God. Number three, a decree, mandate, or order. And key number four is a moral precepts given by God. Number four is our key one that we're going to be looking at, is the moral precepts given by God. So Yeshua says, seek first the moral precepts given by my Father and his kingdom and his righteousness, and everything will be given to you. If you do that, if you follow that simple understanding, then you will be given everything that you could possibly want. Because one, if you're seeking God's kingdom, you're going to really want for nothing, because you're going to be following in spirit and in truth. Now, kingdom, okay? The Greek word is basileia. No, I said it wrong. Basileia. Okay? Seek, that is kingdom. It means royal power, kingship, dominion, rule. Okay? So you're going to be seeking the moral precepts of God. You're going to be seeking his dominion, his rulership over your life. Then everything will be given to you, no matter what you are doing. Okay? Because if you're seeking his kingdom, you're going to seek to follow God's laws in spirit and in truth. Then here, then the next word to understand this sentence fully before we get into some other things that Yeshua said that really spoke to my heart this week. And here in this last word, this word righteousness, okay? Okay, the Greek word means for righteousness, the condition acceptable to God. Number two, the doctrine concerning the way in which man may attain a state of approval of God. And this word that came to me last Sunday, integrity, virtue, purity of life, rightness, correctness of thinking, feeling, and acting. Amen? So first, Yeshua said, seek the moral precepts of the kingship, the dominion that rules over you. Then he says, the righteousness, the doctrine concerning the way which you're supposed to live your life to attain a state of approval by God, so that you will have integrity, purity of life. That's what each and every person, this is why Yeshua came. He threw the ball to you. When he paid the price on the cross, he threw the ball to you and said, now it's your job, because you're in charge of your heart. You don't have to worry about the priesthood anymore. You don't got to worry about the rabbis anymore. You got to worry about yourself. So seek first the moral precepts given by God. Well, what would be those moral precepts given by God? The laws of God, the 613 commandments given by God, okay? That would be the moral precepts. So if somebody says you're being legalistic by doing that, well, you're a fool. Because Yeshua says, seek his moral precepts. What would be the moral precepts? Can I have sex with my mother? No, that would be wrong. Can I have sex with another man? That would be wrong. Can I have sex with a cow? That would be wrong. These are moral precepts that are given in to us in the book of Leviticus. Now, somebody says, you're being legalistic by doing that. No, you're being smart. Because why? I'm seeking first the kingdom of God. Why? For my life. I'm seeking his dominion over my life. Because why? I want to be acceptable to God. I want to have integrity in my life. I want to have purity in my life. Because why? Because Yeshua says, then all these things will be given to me. Okay? How many people don't want more blessings from God? Oh, you know, oh, I've had enough. You know, I've had way too many blessings. Here, Rabbed, here's some of my blessings. I've got so many. Here, throw them over to you. Hey, here's that teenager. She needs some blessings because she's a mess. Groom, okay? Here's a little kid over here. Here, have some more blessings because you know what? I've got too many. No! Who would ever say something like that? I mean, no, Lord, you've just blessed me too much. You've given me way too much. When you get to that point, you know, hey, yeah, bless other people. Amen. Okay? But here, seeking first the kingdom is what our lives are supposed to be about. It is not legalistic. It's love. It's love. Now, why do we start there in this message? Why did the Lord pour this out to me this morning on the treadmill? Okay, because I had something else. I had just the integrity part. That I got last Sunday. Okay, the word integrity was boom, boom, like in my spirit. Integrity, integrity. Nobody's got integrity anymore. Okay? Now, why are we starting there? Because now let's turn to the Gospel of Matthew. The Gospel of Matthew chapter 25. Okay? The Gospel of Matthew chapter 25. Let's look at verse 1 through 12. The Gospel of Matthew chapter 25, verse 1 through 12. This is why you want to seek first the kingdom of God. Now here, this passage I'm entitling, they thought they were part of his family. Matthew 25, verse 1 through 12. Let me just fix this over here. Matthew 25, verses 1 through 12. The kingdom of heaven at that time will be like 10 bridesmaids who took their lamps and went out to meet the groom. Five of them were foolish and five of them were sensible. The foolish ones took lamps with them, but no oil, whereas the other took flasks of oil with their lamps. Now the bridegroom was late, so they all went to sleep. It was the middle of the night when the cry rang out, "The bridegroom is here! Go out to meet him!" The girls all woke up and prepared their lamps for lighting. The foolish ones said to the sensible ones, "Give us some of your oil, because our lamps are going out." "No," they replied, "there may not be enough for both you and us. Go to the oil dealer and buy some for yourselves." And as they were going off to buy, the bridegroom came. Those who were ready went with him to the wedding feast, and the door was shut. Later, the other bridesmaids came. "Sir, sir," they cried, "let us in." But he answered, "Indeed, I tell you, I don't know you." Amen? Now, our key verse here in seeking first the kingdom of God is this. Let's go to verse 12. But he answered, "Indeed, I tell you, I don't know you." Amen? Now, for this message, see, we want to learn how to become part of a Jewish family. One of the key issues that I've constantly preached is it's not about culture. God does not care about where you came from. He cares about where you're going. See, we're supposed to be the bride of Messiah. So you're not a Filipino bride anymore. You're not a Colombian bride anymore. You're not an American bride anymore. You're supposed to become Jewish because Messiah is Jewish. He doesn't care where you came from. You have to leave where you came from and become part of the house of Israel. Okay? If you want to go to the Father's house in heaven, the only people that are going to be in there are Jews and those who want to be part of the Jewish house. Okay? So here, look at verse 12. It's really fascinating. But he answered, "Indeed, I tell you, I don't know you." Amen? Now imagine this. When, you know, I remember a long time ago, I'll be married 28 years in a couple more weeks. Yeah, it's in September, right? We're in September? Yes, we're in September. Okay? So in a few more weeks, I'm going to be married 28 years. Now, I remember planning for my wedding. There was a lot of time, you know, my wife Kelly and I, Robinson Kelly and I, had been together for 3 years. And, you know, so for a year and a half, we were planning the wedding. Imagine, you know, and there was a lot of planning, you know, because my father was dead and her parents couldn't help us. So we were doing this all on our own. Plus, her parents didn't really like her marrying a Jew. Okay, that one didn't go over too well. Her mother liked me, but the father is an Irish Catholic, and you know, his, she should have seen the grandmother. Ooh, goodness gracious. Anyway, I digress. But the reason I'm talking about that, imagine you put all this effort into becoming a bride, into becoming part of that family. You put all this effort in, you put all this time in, you've learned all the culture, you're leaving where you are, you're getting ready to become part of a new family, you're ready to become a bride, you're learning how to cook, you're learning how to clean, you're learning how to iron, you're learning all these wonderful things, because you're now going to leave your parents' house, as it says in Bereshit in Genesis, and the two shall become one flesh. You're going to leave your mother and father, and he's going to cleave to his wife, and they're going to cleave together. They're going to become a family. So imagine you've done all that planning. You've done all that planning, and then you don't have your oil, and you know the bridegroom comes because you weren't ready. You thought he was coming later. You weren't ready. You didn't want to do things, and you still had some more things to do and all this other stuff. And then look at verse 12 again. But he answered, "Indeed, I tell you, I don't know you." Imagine that. Imagine you've lived your whole life as a 4-hour Shabbat keeper. Imagine you lived your whole life as a Sunday Christian, going to church for your 2 or 3 hours, doing your Christmas thing, and doing your Easter thing, doing your New Year's thing. Imagine you've done your Rosh Hashanah on the wrong time, but you've done it, you know, and you've done this, and you've sort of celebrated Yom Kippur, and you didn't fast really, but you know, you were there, you took the day off from work. Imagine you get there, and look at verse 11. Let the other bridesmaids... Later, the other bridesmaids came, "Sir, sir," they cried, "let us in." Okay? Imagine you've lived your whole life waiting for this moment, and then you get there, and they won't let you in. Imagine that. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. It's not about being legalistic. It's about learning what your job is. It's about an uncircumcised heart becoming a circumcised heart. That's what it's about. You've lived your whole life to become a bride of Messiah, and then you get up there, "Let me in, let me in," and the door's locked. But sir, I've done all this. You know, but why won't you let me in? And Yeshua comes, and we'll see what he says to you. Imagine that. Imagine you've done all this planning, you've done all this saving, you set up an apartment, you know, you got this little place for you and your husband, you know, you got the two of you, you're gonna have, you know, you got a little table maybe, or maybe even got boxes to sit on, you know, but it's your place. Imagine that day, and you don't make the wedding. Look at verse 12. But he answered, "Indeed, I tell you, I don't know you." Imagine you're there, but I'm ready now. But I'm ready now. And they won't let you in because Yeshua has given them orders. I've shut the door. They missed their opportunity to catch the Messiah. "Let us in, let us in." Verse 11, "Let us in." Later the other bridesmaids came, "Sir, sir," they cried, "let us in." Imagine that. You've lived your whole life for this moment, and now you lived your whole life wanting to become part of God's family, but you didn't really want to do the things that you needed to do. You saw the signs, but you didn't want to do the things. You read the word, but you didn't want to do what it says. You read the Torah, but you know people were telling you, you don't have to do those things anymore because Messiah has come. Huh. Turn to Luke 13. Luke 13. Let's see what else Yeshua says. Luke 13, verse 22 to 28. Luke 13, verse 22 to 28. Luke 13, verse 22 to 28. This part is called, they thought they were part of his family because they ate at his table once. Yeshua continued traveling through the town after town and village after village, teaching and making his way toward Jerusalem. Someone asked him, are only a few people being saved? He answered, struggle to get in through the narrow door, because I'm telling you, many will be demanding to get in and won't be able to. Once the owner of the house has gotten up and shut the door, you will stand outside knocking at the door and saying, Lord, open up for us. But he will answer, I don't know you or where you come from. Then you'll say, we ate and drank with you. You taught in our streets. And he will tell you, I don't know where you're from. Get away from me, all you workers of wickedness. You will cry and grind your teeth when you see Abraham, Yitzhak, and Yaakov, and all the prophets inside the kingdom of God, but you yourselves outside. Amen? Key verses are 26 to 28 again. Let's read those again. You want to be part of his family. It's about love. And if Yeshua said, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments. Then you will say, we ate and drank with you. You taught in our streets. And he will tell you, I don't know where you're from. Get away from me, you all you workers of wickedness. You will cry and grind your teeth when you see Abraham, Yitzhak, and Yaakov, and all the prophets inside the kingdom of God, but you yourselves outside. Amen? You thought you were part of his family, but you didn't want to do. What did it say? Look at verse 24. What did it say? He answered, struggle to get in through the narrow door because I'm telling you, many will be demanding to get in but won't be able to. Amen? Struggle. Struggle. That means following the commandments. It's a heart issue. Get a circumcised heart. Get a circumcised heart. A circumcised heart means leaving the world and its ways and following Yeshua, the Messiah. Okay? It's not, well, Paul says it's the letter kills. Yeshua says struggle to get in. I'm going to follow Yeshua. You're misunderstanding Paul. I'm going to follow Yeshua because he's my Messiah. He is the Son of God. He says struggle to get in. What does he mean, struggle to get in? That means leaving the world and following the commandments of God. How will I know the commandments of God? Well, they're written down. They're written down in the Torah. In the five books of Moses, they're written down in the Torah, the books that you're going to be judged upon. Struggle. Now look at verse 24 again. He answered, struggle to get in through the narrow door because I'm telling you, many will be demanding to get in and won't be able to. They'll demand to get in. They're thinking they're part of his family. So all your life, you've sort of done Shabbats. All your life, you thought you were a Christian. And, you know, I'm covered in the blood of Jesus. And he's going to say to you, you didn't struggle. You didn't work to leave the old life. You left some things, but, you know, you read what you were supposed to do. You were supposed to leave the corner of your field. You farmer for the poor people and the widows, but you didn't want to do it. You wanted the money. You were supposed to cover your head if you were a married woman, but you refused to. And what's he going to say? I'm going to demand again. Well, I couldn't do it. I didn't feel this way. You were supposed to let your beard grow. Well, I don't really have a beard. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. Struggle. Struggle because it's all about your heart. God said, that means you do. It's not legalism. It's love. Legalism is you have to do it this way. That's what Yeshua was talking about. You don't do netilat yadalayim. You don't wash your hands in a certain way. Well, where does it say I'm supposed to wash my hands in a certain way? Who says I have to wash my hands before I eat? Where does it say that? It's all about love. It's all about a circumcised heart. A circumcised heart wants to do what God said to do. That's the spirit of the law. I want to do it because why? I was a pagan and God forgave me. Now I know the truth, and the truth will set me free. Look at verse 26 to 28. Then you will say, we ate and drank with you. You taught in our streets. And he will tell you, I don't know where you're from. Get away from me, all you workers of wickedness. You will cry and grind your teeth when you see Abraham, Yitzhak, and Yaakov, and all the prophets inside the kingdom of God. But you yourselves thrown outside. Amen? Imagine you worked all your life. You tried to do certain things, but you didn't want to do other things. And he's saying, Yeshua's saying this. Yeshua is saying this. The Messiah is saying this. The one who's all about love that the Christian church wants to do. And some messianic silly people that don't want to teach the law say this. Yeshua's saying, but you yourselves thrown outside. Well, why? Look at verse 26. Then you will say, we ate and drank with you. You taught in our streets. Amen? But in verse 28, he's saying, you're thrown out. Evidently, you didn't get the lesson. By what Yeshua's saying in the second part of Yeshua's words. The second part of Yeshua's words. In verse 27, he says, get away from me. Imagine Yeshua saying this. But Lord, I love you. I love you. Did you keep the Sabbath holy? Did you cook? Did you make your slaves work on Sabbath? When you found out the truth, did you stop doing those things? When you read that you're supposed to keep your beard long, well, in our culture, we don't do that. God doesn't give a damn about your culture. You're supposed to become Jewish. You're supposed to become a Hebrew. Crossing over from where you were, being a British person, to being an Israelite. God doesn't respect man. You're supposed to respect God. Who are you to question the potter? It's all about your heart. He knows your heart. He says, get away from me, you worker of wickedness. Imagine that. You've worked all your life. You've lived 90 years, 100 years, 110 years. Yes, I got up there. And Yeshua says to you, I don't know where you're from. You were supposed to cross over and leave the church doctrine behind. You were supposed to cross over and leave rabbinic teachings behind and follow the way, the truth, and the way, the life. Yeshua's way of life, not my way of life. You're supposed to take off your Roman eyes, 2,000-year-old glasses, and become a Hebrew. I had a lot of stuff to get rid of. I was a Jew by birth. I had a bar mitzvah. I went to yeshiva. But I didn't want it. My parents weren't living alone. My mother was a smoker. My father was a smoker. They didn't curse that much. Okay? But they were not wanting to follow God. And that passed on to me. It was the 70s. Big hair. I mean, it's funny. Today you see afros again. I'm like, wow, that looks just like my sister. I see Joshua's daughter, Hadassah. It's like, wow, that is my sister's hair. Poof! Okay? I see that and I'm like, wow. But that was the decadence. That's where the decadence began, the 70s, where people just escalated their garbage. And I was part of that. And I kept living life on the edge with women, wine, women, and song, rock and roll. Absolutely. But then the Lord walked into my life. And he changed my heart of stone for a heart of flesh. He said, here, you've made a lot of mistakes. You've paid for an abortion. Not one, but two. Now, go sin no more. Before that, he would say to me, get away from me, you worker of wickedness. And he would have been right. I pay no, my life is an open book. You can't talk to me about money or my bedroom. The rest of it, I'm very open about. Why? because a good testimony from where you were to where you're going with a circumcised heart is not about legalism. It's about love. It's about a man that is God, who came off his throne to show you how to live your life. It took a beating for you so that you would have an opportunity. Now here in verse 26, he says, you know, you ate and drank with him. You taught in our streets. He came to teach. He came to show. He came to be an example for us to follow. Oh, but Paul says, I don't give a damn what Paul says. To be honest with you, yeah, it's the Bible. I'm not saying it's not. But you're misreading it. If it's contradicting Yeshua, I'm following the one who's going to say, that one's mine. The sheep know his voice. The sheep know his voice. Do you know? Or is Paul your master? Paul says, don't follow me. I'm going to follow Yeshua. Look at verse 27. And he will tell you, I don't know where you're from. Get away from me, all you workers of wickedness. Amen? Well, what would be wickedness? How would I know what this wickedness is, Yeshua? So I don't want to be that person. Because we're all going to die. Everybody's going to die, and you're going to go on to the next life. How do I know what is wickedness? How do I know? Well, that would be following the Torah. That would be getting a circumcised heart. That would be following the legal document called the Torah. People say that legalism are being misled by the devil. Because God wrote his law down and he gave it to us and he said, this is your life. And if that's being legal, then, well, who am I to say, God, you're wrong? Well, I like, you know, girls with big hands. You know, I like this. I like blondes. I like brunettes. I like redheads. What? Who am I to say that to God? What he's saying to me, I don't want him to say this to me. Get away from me, all you workers of wickedness. All. Look at that. All. Cold. All. That's a lot of people. Why? Because there's a lot of bad teachers out there. Even those that call themselves messianic, there's a lot of bad teachers. If they're saying we're doing Rosh Hashanah, run from them. They're just being rabbinic. Rosh Hashanah is at Passover. It says, what does it say in Leviticus 23? Yom Teruah. If you're doing Rosh Hashanah and you're calling yourself messianic, you're a Jewish temple with a little Yeshua cherry, and that's not good enough for me. Look at verse 28. You will cry and grind your teeth when you see Abraham, Yitzhak, and Yaakov and all the prophets inside the kingdom of God, but you yourselves thrown outside. Amen? This is Yeshua saying, I'm going to throw your butt outside. And where's outside? It ain't outside in a, you know, on the street. When he says, I'm going to throw you outside, that's into Sheol. That's into hell. That's Yeshua saying it. If you're not in his house, you're in a bad neighborhood. And Satan's just waiting for you to come there. He's going to say to you, yeah, you listen to me. Now you're mine. Because you didn't, God's going to say, told you so. Told you so. Look at verse 24 again. He answered, struggle to get in through the narrow door, because I'm telling you, many will be demanding to get in and won't be able to. Amen? That means they live their life thinking they're a follower of Yeshua or Jesus. Or as I like to say, Jesus. 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 Okay? I'm going to demand to get in. You should have lived your life with a circumcised heart. What's a circumcised heart? Obedience. Deuteronomy 10, obedience to God's word. Circumcised heart, that's the first time it's found. Circumcised heart is found in Deuteronomy 10. Struggle. It's hard. Yeshua was telling us right there in verse 24. Why is he saying it? There's nothing different about what the time he lived in the time that we're in today, except there's more technology. There's different things, but the life is the same. And when he pours out the Spirit on you, it means you struggle to get in. Struggle because why? It was a Hellenistic society. Everywhere around all the Israelites was pagan garbage. Just like there is today. Many flavors, many different gods. There's 1,500 denominations of Christianity, and I don't even know how many different tiles of Messianic Judaism there is today. But there's only one path, and it's a narrow path. And not many people teach it because they're afraid to lose people. I don't want your blood on my hands, okay? If you don't like my style, well, that's different. But you can't find fault in any of the teachings. Anybody come with me with the teachings. Come strong against the teachings. And we'll play chess, and I'll win. But when we play, we're going to put our souls on the line. We're going to put our children's souls on the line. And our grandchildren. To the third and fourth generation. I'll stand and I'll prove what I believe through the scriptures. Yeshua is saying struggle because why? It was a Hellenistic society. There were all these pagan stuff around. And Judaism had a lot of paganism between Malachi and Matthew's 400 years called the Dark Ages. It's dark time, the dead period. God didn't speak. And people did whatever was right in their own eyes. So Yeshua is saying, now that I've come, struggled to get a good heart, struggle to get a circumcised heart because it's your heart. You have to struggle to get into the narrow gate. You got to struggle away from the world because, oh, well, you don't have to do that. Well, Paul says we don't have to do that. Well, Yeshua is saying right here in verse 24, struggle to get into the gate. Paul says, it's the letter of the law kills. Well, evidently, in the 2 weeks that he met with the disciples, he didn't learn this lesson. Yeshua, the Messiah, the Son of God, is saying, struggle! What's so hard about that? Well, Paul says, it's legalism. No, it's called love. It's called salvation. It's called not being a prostitute. He paid 39 lashes for your sorry butt. And you want to live the way you want. Well, I can't do that. Well, he's going to say, you're going to be demanding to get in, and I'm going to turn a deaf ear towards you. This is Yeshua talking. I'm sorry if I've been a little zealous. There's been some silliness going on this weekend. 27 and 28. As God pours out his Spirit. I said to my son coming in, is this supposed to rain today? He said, no. You are incredible. May you be blessed. And he will tell you, I don't know where you're from. Thank you. Get away from me, all you workers of wickedness. You will cry and grind your teeth when you see Abraham, Yitzhak, and Yaakov, and all the prophets inside the kingdom of God, but you yourselves thrown outside. Amen? Why does he say Abraham, Yitzhak, and Yaakov? These are three men that made a lot of blunders, but in the end of their lives, they really trusted in the word of God. Why does he say the prophets? What's the prophet's job? To tell you you're doing wrong, to be very legal with God's word. But Yeshua is saying, they're there. So they were being really legalistic by telling, Jeremiah was telling the leadership, you're doing wrong. Isaiah was saying, you're doing wrong. Hosea was saying, you're doing wrong. Malachi was saying, you're doing wrong. That's real legalistic. But God is saying, they're in the kingdom. So when somebody says you're being legalistic, you say, well, I guess so. Thanks. Because maybe I'll be with the rest of the fellas. Look at verse 25. This is a scary verse. This is a real scary verse. Once the owner of the house has gotten up and shut the door, you will stand outside knocking at the door and saying, Lord, open up for us. But he will answer, I don't know where you come from? But I accepted you. But I accepted you. I left Sunday worship. Well, you know, I cooked a bit on Shabbat. I didn't want to cover my head. I looked at a few women. I looked at a few men. You know, come on, you made everything beautiful. Yeshua said, he's going to answer. I don't know where you come from. Because you're not part of my family. You wanted to be British. You wanted to be Irish. Scottish. You wanted to be from India. You wanted to be Ireland. Ireland, yes, lassie. Scottish. You wanted to be Scottish. You wanted to be from Colombia. Estados Unidos. You wanted to stay there. Yeshua said, leave that and become part of my family. Turn to Matthew 7. Matthew 7. You learning anything? Is the message clear? Matthew 7, verse 21 to 23. Matthew 7, verse 21 to 23. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven. Only those who do what my Father in heaven wants. On that day, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, didn't we prophesy in your name? Didn't we expel demons in your name? Didn't we perform many miracles in your name? Now I will tell them to their faces, I never knew you. Get away from me, you worker of lawlessness. Amen? Wow. Look at verse 21. Look at verse 21. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven. Only those who do what my Father in heaven wants. Amen? You legalist, Yeshua. You're legalist. The letter kills. The letter kills. Evidently, Yeshua doesn't agree with that. Evidently, the only ones that are going to get into the kingdom of heaven are those who do what the Father in heaven wants. How will I know what the Father in heaven wants? How will I know that? Well, does he like broccoli? Evidently not, because he accepted the animal offering and not the vegetable offering, Cain and Abel. Okay? How will I know what the Father in heaven wants? It's called 613, 613. It lives inside of me. It lives inside of me. 613, 613. It lives inside of me. If that's being legalistic, then I'm going to do it because you know what? My Messiah, Yeshua, says, do it. Look at verse 22. On that day, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, didn't we prophesy in your name? Didn't we expel demons in your name? Didn't we perform many miracles in your name? Amen? These are followers. These people think they're saved. Prophesy. Well, I'm prophesying. I know Jesus. I know Jesus. Didn't we expel demons in your name? And it happened. Didn't we perform many miracles in your name? And this all happened. This all happened. God used you as a tool. You weren't the one prophesying. You weren't the one expelling demons. God is the one who expels demons. You weren't the one doing the miracles. It was God working through you. But evidently, you didn't have a circumcised heart because you didn't want to follow the laws of God. Only those who do what my Father in heaven wants, only those are going to be getting into heaven. But you know, we brought the Gentiles. We brought the Gentiles the word on Shabbat. We were serving food. But it was okay because we were telling them about Shabbat. Let me get something straight. So you're in a restaurant, not in a private facility, not in a private room. And you're getting food served to you. And you're making people work. When it specifically says in the Shabbat laws, don't make your daughter, your son, your daughter, your ox, your cow, and your slaves work. And in Exodus 16, what does it say? Don't cook. You make a double portion on Shabbat prep day. But you evidently don't know this. But we prophesied in your name. And those prophecies came true. And you know what? We expelled many demons in your name. Yeah, yes, and those people were good. And you know what? We called down and we made many miracles in your name. And it happened. It happened. Then look at verse 23. Then I will tell them to their faces, I never knew you. Get away from me, you workers of lawlessness. Imagine, you've done this all your life. You've sort of done Shabbat. You've sort of done the holy days. You know, I was at Passover at my mom's house for second night. I don't know whether there's a second night that's called Hot Matzah. But, you know, but you were there. And the Lord's saying, I know your heart. I know your heart. You don't have a circumcised heart. You're a worker of lawlessness. You can't have one foot in the church and one foot in the Bible. You have to have both feet on the path of the way. Yeshua's the way. Well, Paul says it doesn't matter what day you worship on. I don't give a damn what Paul says. Yeshua said, I'm the Lord of the Sabbath. Yeshua's my Messiah. I'm following him. Because he said, nobody gets in heaven except through me. Not through Paul, through me. Through me! The letter kills. No, your heart kills you. Love. A circumcised heart means I don't want those things anymore. I have to do what I have to do. The 34 categories, if that's the categories you want to go with, that's fine. You have to figure out what you need. Because it's a bad time to find out. but Lord, you know, come on, Poppy. You know, come on, we're friends. Come on, Yeshua. Come on, we're pals. I expelled demons in your name. All that work I did for you. And he turns around and says to you, to your face. To your face. To your face. You're supposed to be my watchman. And you were afraid to look different. You were supposed to be my watchman, telling the truth to all the people. I anointed you. Now I'm going to tell you to your face, get away from me, you worker of lawlessness. Woo, that's a bad time to find out. Oh, couldn't you have told me earlier? I did. It's in my word. Torah is supposed to be life to the follower of God. Why is that so hard? Because we're afraid. We don't trust God. Let's recap these three. Matthew 25:12. But he said, indeed I tell you, I don't know you. Luke 13, verse 28. You will cry and grind your teeth when you see Abraham, Yitzhak, and Yaakov, and all the prophets inside the kingdom of God, but you yourself thrown outside. Matthew 7, verse 23, then I would tell them to their faces, I never knew you. Get away from me, you workers of lawlessness. Now, let's turn to Revelation 22. Revelation 22. Let me just close it. Revelation 22, verse 14 and 15. I guess the Lord is pouring out his living water. Revelation 22, verse 14 and 15. hopefully you're learning something on this Erev Shabbat. It's going to keep your feet planted on the righteous path. How blessed are those who wash their robes so that they have the right to eat from the tree of life and go through the gates into the city. Outside are the homosexuals, those involved with the occult and with drugs, the sexually immoral, the murderers, idol worshippers, and everyone who loves and practices falsehood. Go to verse 16. I, Yeshua, have sent my angel to give you this testimony. For the Messianic communities, I am the root and the offspring of David, the bright and morning star. Amen. So we know from verse 16, this is Yeshua who's he sent his angel to give the testimony. Now we go back to verse 15. Outside of the homosexuals, those involved with the occult and with the drugs, the sexually immoral, murderers, idol worshiper, and everyone who loves and practices falsehood. For this particular teaching, what we're focusing on is practicing falsehood. What does that mean? What does that mean? See, practicing falsehood means when somebody says you're being legalistic, that means that person who said it is practicing falsehood. Because if you're trying to be like Yeshua in everything that you do, then you're going to get in. Practicing falsehood, how will I know what is false and what is true? If this is the testimony of Yeshua, Paul hasn't written his letters to the Messianic congregation in Colossae, Ephesus, and every other place that he's written to. What would this be? How will I know? I have to go to the legal document called the Torah. Now, if you're going to a place that doesn't teach this, then run. It's better to be alone than to be with snakes. I was in a place with snakes. I asked the main guy, why are we doing Sunday? Well, because we can talk to the Gentiles, as one of the founders said, who's now dead. You know, we got to make it palatable to the Gentiles. And I was like, doesn't the Torah say if you do what I want, says Jehovah, I'll make them come to you no matter what you're doing? So if you do what's right in God's sight, he's going to bring the people to you. They're going to find a way to meet you. So if you want to get in, stop practicing falsehood. Go to Matthew 19. Matthew 19, because a lot of people are now saying, oh my goodness, how can anybody be saved? Matthew 19, how can anybody be saved? By not getting tangled up in the world. Matthew 19, verse 25 to 29. Matthew 19, verse 25 to 29. Matthew 19, verse 25 to 29. When the Talmudim heard this, they were utterly amazed. Then who? They asked, can be saved? Yeshua looked at them and said, humanly, this is impossible. But with God, everything is possible. Kepha replied, look, we have left everything and followed you. So what will we have? Yeshua said to them, yes, I tell you that in the regenerated world, when the Son of Man sits on his glorious throne, you who have followed me will also sit on 12 thrones and judge the 12 tribes of Israel. Anyone who has left houses, brothers, sisters, father, mother, children, or fields for my sake will receive 100 times more, and he will obtain eternal life. Amen. Look at verse 25. When the Talmudim heard this, they were utterly amazed. Then who, they ask, can be saved? Amen. Many people, when they hear this, they get scared. It's good. You should fear God. But he's not a bad father. He's a loving father. He wants to see his children doing their best, and then he will facilitate some help to you. If he sees you trying your best, like, oh man, I did that again. But if you try, he's not a God that says, yeah, let's see if you can do it. He wants an effort from you. For many rabbis, and certainly non-Messianic Gentile pastors who do not preach this solid biblical truth, this is scary to them. Because why? Because they've never been discipled. That's why we are very strong on discipleship here. Strong discipleship. Because I don't respect people. I respect God. I respect Jehovah the Father, His Son Yeshua, and the Ruach HaKodesh. And the Ruach HaKodesh, His single job is to remind 8 billion people on this planet right now of the 613 laws. That's His single, solitary job. That's a lot of jobs. But if you're in a place that doesn't teach you how to obtain eternal life, then you have to question where you are. And that's why we're keeping the teachings going. You have to question. Somebody says, that's being legalistic. Well, how do I obtain eternal life? I just got to say I believe in Jesus. No. Satan believes in Messiah. He doesn't want to follow Him. How do I obtain eternal life? I get a circumcised heart. Well, what does that mean? A circumcised heart means leaving the old life and trusting in His laws. Look at verse 28. Yeshua said to them, yes, I tell you that in the regenerated world, when the Son of Man sits on His glorious throne, you who have followed Me will also sit on 12 thrones and judge the 12 tribes of Israel. Amen? Those who have followed Him. Well, what does that mean? Doing what He did. It's that simple. Follow His example. Well, Paul says. No, Paul's not God. Paul is a man that just heard the voice of Messiah. Is those other book, those letters in the Bible, part of the Scriptures? Yes, of the Bible. It's part of the New Testament. It's there. It's for a purpose. Okay? But when you need to know the truth of what is needed, go back to Messiah's words. Don't be a supersessionist. Well, this comes after. That's why we went to the Revelation scripture. If you're a supersessionist, the last book of the Bible is what? Revelation. That's why we read that. Outside is a certain group of people. If you're always quoting Paul's writings, then your Roman mind is not allowing you to follow the commandments. Because Paul seems to just, you know, he's dealing with basic understanding. That's what he's doing. Basic understanding. He's not getting deep. He does get deep later in his letters, especially in the book of Romans. Go to Matthew 12. Matthew 12. Verse 48 to 50. Five more minutes. Hope you learn on this Erev Shabbat teaching. Because now it's good to have one language. Tomorrow will be the rest of this. Matthew 12, verse 48 to 50. With the one who had informed him, he replied, "Who is my mother? Who are my brothers?" Pointing to his Talmudim, he said, "Look, here are my mother and brothers. Whoever does what my Father in heaven wants, that person is my brother and sister and mother." Amen. You legalist, Yeshua! You're so legal! He's the Son of God. He's a perfect Messiah. He says, "Who are my mother and brothers?" Those who do what my Father in heaven wants. How do I know what your Father in heaven wants, Yeshua? Where will I find that? Well, that would be in the Torah. Well, we like to read the prophets. Yes, what was the prophet's job? What's the single purpose of a prophet? To tell you to come back to God. Because why? You're living in a Hellenistic society. How do I know what God, how do you know what your Father in heaven wants? You got to read. You have to circumcise your heart. You have to choose life. Whoever does what Paul wants gets into heaven? No. Whoever says we no longer have to circumcise our children, are they getting into heaven? No. So we can stop, you know, we're under grace, we don't have to circumcise our children anymore. When did Yeshua say that? He just said, whoever does what my Father in heaven wants. So on the eighth day when a boy is born, what do? We circumcise him. Because, see, when you circumcise later, you're gonna know it. You're going to remember it. It's going to be painful. God wants you to remember, you left the paganism. So circumcision means uncovering something. Something to remove. It's going to be painful. You're going to remember it. Think Abraham remembered it? Yeah. Think Yitzhak did? No. 8 days old. Who can remember when they're 8 days old? Matthew 12, verse 50. Whoever does what my Father in heaven wants, that person is my brother and sister and mother. So did the King Jehovah say in Shemot 16 that you can cook on Shabbat? In Shemot Exodus 16, can we cook on Shabbat? I mean, how hard is that to understand? Bake what you want to bake, boil what you want to boil, because I'm not going to give you anything on Shabbat. Well, we want to witness to the Gentiles. They're coming out of the church, so we're going to meet with them. So you do pagan things? Well, how is that going to work? How is that going to work? Because there were some that went to collect. In Exodus 16, there were some that went to collect on Shabbat, right? Right? They didn't have a circumcised heart. They didn't want to listen. So God got really angry. Really angry. 1 John, please. 1 John, chapter 2. 1 John, a disciple of Yeshua, a person that was learned. He walked with Yeshua for a few years. I think he would know his master. So he says something very interesting. 1 John, chapter 2, verse 17. And the world is passing away along with its desires, but whoever does God's will remains forever. That was so good, John. I'm going to read it again. Yochanan. 1 Yochanan, chapter 2, verse 17. And the world is passing away along with its desires, but whoever does God's will remains forever. How, Yochanan, would I know what God's will is? People tell me that's being legalistic. God is a very legal person. Well, person, quotations. He's very jealous. And when you change his word, he gets angry. And when God is angry, you're sad. You want to make the Father in heaven happy. You want to live forever in a nice neighborhood with streets of gold. So love is about allowing your heart to get circumcised, leaving the old life behind, and choosing to follow God. But when you choose, you read it, and you say you don't want to do it, that's open rebellion. The letter kills. No, Paul. Stupidity kills. Disobedience kills. Open rebellion kills. Wait. Chava was open rebellious. So she died because she was separated from God. The letter is life, not death. The letter is death to the old life. Recap. Matthew 25, verse 12. He answered, indeed, I tell you, I don't know you. Luke 13, verse 28. You will cry and grind your teeth when you see Abraham, Yitzhak, and Yaakov, and all the prophets inside the kingdom of God, but you yourselves thrown outside. Matthew 7, verse 23, then I tell them to their faces, I never knew you. Get away from me, you workers of lawlessness. Now go back to Matthew 6, where we started, and we'll close on this. You can't go wrong with this verse. Matthew 6, verse 33, and we will close. But seek first the kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you. Seek the Logos. Seek the Word. Seek the example of Messiah. Seek his way, his truth, his life. And what will be given to you? Truth. Because you know what? The truth will set you free. Amen. And amen. And amen.
Shalom. This is Messianic Rabbi Andrew Dinnerman. I would personally like to thank you for tuning in to the Remnant's Call each and every week. You can listen to the full message on our website, bethgoyim.org. If you have drawn closer to the King of Kings, learned more about him today, we are blessed. If you are blessed by these messages, please consider a donation to our ministry. You can go to our website, bethgoyim.org. That's BETHGOYIM.org. And click on the donate button. You do not have to have a PayPal account to donate. All you need is a debit card. Once again, thank you very much for listening to The Remnant's Call.
If you have not taken your first steps to be born again, just ask God's help. Remember, it's His loving grace that has come to find you. No one is worthy or able to reach God, but God can reach us, and He's reaching out to you now. Just open your heart and let Him in. His arms are open, and the blessing of salvation and eternal life are waiting for you. Don't let it wait any longer.
Shalom. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord lift his face and shine upon you. May the Lord be gracious unto you and give you his shalom.
Shalom. My name is Messianic Rabbi Andrew Dinnerman, and I invite you to come to visit our congregation. If you are in the tri-state area, come out and visit with us on Shabbat. We are a congregation of Jews and Gentiles living as one in the Messiah Yeshua. BGMC is a place of true worship. The focus never wanders from the Hebraic roots of our faith. Beth Goyim is rooted in the Word of God from Bereshit through to the Book of Revelation. Messiah's strong words against man-made tradition are carefully recorded in Matthew 7. That is the reason we only follow the straight-up instructions found in Scripture. Truly, the way, the truth, and the life. If you're looking for a deeper walk with Adonai, come out for our Tuesday evening Bible study called Messianic Torah Time. Come, spend a day with us on any Shabbat. We start at 11 a.m. with the sound of the ancient Hebrew shofar. Next, we offer our King praise and worship in English, Hebrew, and Spanish. After worship, we review the headlines in the previous week's news from around the globe, especially news from the Holy Land Israel. We don't just list the news headlines as current events, but we comb through the scriptures, searching for clues to understand what they mean, and then to help pinpoint prophetically our current position on Adonai's clock. After digesting all that modern information, we leave the world behind as we journey with our Adonai deep into his eternal word. Not with just one or two scriptures, but usually seven or more scriptures. The spiritual nourishment and the richness of his kingdom become accessible
to the ones who share this special time and seek them out. The day does not end there. Because Shabbat is so special to Him, there is always so much more that our King desires to share. So instead of separating and leaving, we stay together as a family for potluck lunch and an afternoon study of our King's Word. We close the Shabbat together with the reading of the new week's parasha. That's the Torah portion. Even after those blessings, many of us just can't get enough. So the members bring prepared homemade foods to share while we all enjoy an uplifting movie together. If all that information is not quite enough, you can check out our website where you will find over 200 video teachings and biblical holy day studies. Under Messianic Torah Time, the Hebrew Roots button, you'll discover free studies on many, many different topics, including PowerPoint slide presentations. If Beth Goyim sounds like a place you'd love to visit, but you live outside the tri-state area, there is still a way to connect with us. We stream live on the internet on Tuesday, Thursday, and Shabbat. The website is www.bethgoyim.org. That's BETHGOYIM.org. Our phone number is 973-338-7800 or 978-2-YESHUA. That's 978, the number 2, Yeshua. Shalom.